Good evening, friends. Hope all of you are fine. At the onset, I would like to thank TAS and Dr. Hetal for considering me for this Facebook Live presentation. Though I am technologically challenged, I will try my best. This is indeed the future way. Paravertebral block has always been my favorite because I started doing it in 2007. That is in the pre-smartphone era, and evolved myself slowly over the years by trial and error, learning from patients' response. As a small nursing home practitioner, we tend to depend upon blocks as a sole anesthetic agent to keep it to minimum, especially for high-risk cases, as we tend to have no additional help, and also more for LOR and PMS guided blocks since there are no USG available. Regional blocks are sole anesthesia. It's most commonly used in upper limb blocks where along the brachial plexus blocks are given, and lower limb surgeries you can give femoral, sciatic, and you can tweak the epidural and the spinal. But what about chest and thoracic surgeries? General anesthesia has been the conventional method for years long. But what if we need to do under regional as a sole anesthetic? What are the options we have? Thoracic epidural, thoracic spinal, thoracic paravertebral block, PECS block, intercostal blocks, and serratus plane block. Thoracic epidural needs expertise, the epidural space being narrow there. You can have inadvertent dural puncture and cord injuries. And if we get the space, sometimes we find the catheter placement to be very difficult. Bilateral sympathetic blockade and cardioaccelerator fibers can cause hypotension, especially in high-risk cardiac patients. Also, even minimal amount of respiratory muscle weakness can be problematic in some patients. Urinary retention and late ambulation are also seen in some. Thoracic or segmental spinal. This have been very well explained and discussed by pioneers like Dr. Paliwal, and Dr. Vagela even presented a case last week. Even though the block is intense, there can be cardioaccelerator fiber blockade leading to bradycardia, hypotension. Bilateral sympathetic blockade is there. Respiratory arrest due to bilateral respiratory muscle paralysis, especially ASA grade 3 and 4, leading to sudden collapse of such patients. Inherent fear of cord damage is also present. Urinary retention and late ambulation can sometimes happen. Intercostal blockade, there the scapula interferes in the upper thoracic levels. You need multiple injections. It's highly vascular, therefore easily absorbed, and the duration is very short, and there is always a risk of LA toxicity. In all, the block is inadequate. PECS, and that is the pectoral blocks 1 and 2, and the serratus anterior plane block, all are inadequate as sole anesthetic agent. Now what if you get a block which is as effective as spinal or epidural, which gives less hypotension, which gives you less sympathetic blockade, which has less motor blockade, and hence there is less risk of sudden cardiorespiratory collapse. Similar to a unilateral epidural, wherein you are able to control or modify the exact dermatomes to be operated upon to get a stable hemodynamic and ambulatory patient. All this can be exactly achieved by paravertebral block. Going into the history, Hugo Sinheim first in 1905 pioneered the concept of paravertebral block in Leipzig he as a gynecologist. Okay, being a gynecologist, he used it to produce abdominal analgesia. Later, Arthur Levin refined the technique in 1911 and called it paravertebral conduction analgesia. Kappes in 1919 developed it further to make it comparable to present day to produce surgical anesthesia for abdominal surgeries. Then it was neglected for some time till Eisen and Watt in 1979 revisited and rekindled the interest by describing the catheter technique. Last two decades have seen renewed interest by main researchers, that is Sabanathan, Richardson, Longquist and R. Karmakar sir, improving it to our current understanding. Now, what is paravertebral space? We have here the epidural space, the spinal space, then comes the epidural space, then the nerve roots emerge from the intervertebral foramen and lie for some distance in a small space adjacent to the vertebral body beneath the transverse process here before continuing as the intercostal nerve here. This wedge-shaped space located on the either side of the vertebral column is the paravertebral space. Okay. The base is formed by the vertebral body and the apex lies lateral at the intercostal space. Anterolaterally, this is most important, anterolaterally lies your parietal pleura. Posteriorly, you have the transverse process and your superior costotransverse ligament. This is again important because this is the ligament which is pierced from behind to enter the paravertebral space. The paravertebral space contains fibroelastic tissue and the endothoracic fascia. Importance of which is that it's a potential space unlike our spinal and epidural, and therefore when you inject, because of the fibroelastic tissue, you get certain resistance to injection. And this endothoracic fascia divides the paravertebral space into two compartments, that is the anterior and the posterior compartment. Anterior compartment is an extra pleural paravertebral space, which is a continuous column longitudinally. Drug when deposited here in this anterior column covers more dermatomes up and down. This space is mostly reached when you use your sonography guided or PNS guided. Okay. Therefore, a single injection here covers multiple dermatomes. The posterior or the subendothoracic paravertebral compartment is not a very continuous column. Mostly this is reached during your LOR or landmark guided blocks. Here there is no guaranteed spread longitudinally. Therefore, you need multiple injections in LOR block. What are the nerves that are blocked in a paravertebral block? The spinal root coming out of the intervertebral foramen divides into two branches, that is the ventral and the dorsal. The dorsal continues as your intercostal nerve. There is a sympathetic chain lying anteriorly here. All these three are blocked, giving us a ipsilateral sensory, motor and sympathetic block. Now, while using the PNS, you tend to stimulate the dorsal nerve. Okay, hence the end motor response is the intercostal muscle contraction, which is supplied by that particular nerve. And here in, you can see that the spinal nerves are devoid of any myelin sheath. They are bare. Hence, even minimal dose of your local anesthetic agent, that is 2 to 3 ml, can give you a direct and quick action. Okay. Though it may not spread in many dermatomes, but the action is immediate and effective. Now, coming to the drug spread. Now, the drug injected into the paravertebral space spreads to dermatomes above and below at the point of injection, more so in the anterior compartment. Medially, it spreads into your epidural space and laterally into the intercostal space. Here you have to remember one point, that once you get the good contraction or good space, and if you inject more, not necessarily all the drug are transferred longitudinally. Sometimes if you are injecting with enough, more than enough pressure rather, it can go into the contralateral side of the epidural space and give you a bilateral epidural block, and this can be disastrous in compromised patients. Hence, a volume of around 5 to 10 ml is enough here. Coming to the landmarks, the most prominent spinous process is your C7. Okay, now the scapular spine transects here at the T3 level, and the inferior angle of your scapula corresponds to your T7. Now in thorax, the spinous process, if you see, are pointing downwards. Okay, so the tip of the spinous process of a vertebra above is in line with the transverse process of the vertebra 1 below. That is, a TC7 will lie in line with the T1, and T1 will lie, spinous process will lie in line with your T2. Okay. Also, you have to note the curvature of the spine. Now, the spine curvature is in such a way that the transverse process is deepest. See, you can see from behind, if you go from skin, the transverse process is deepest at the cervical and your lumbar levels, and it is shallowest at the thoracic, that is a mid thoracic from T5 to T10. So now how do you mark? This is your markings of the tip of the spinous process. Okay, in the midline, you can see they are marked from C7 to T7. Okay, and adjacent to it lies the transverse process of the vertebra 1 below it, that is the T1. Now, how do you measure the distance from the spinous process to the point of entry? There are many formulas available, but for all practical purposes, we take 3 centimeters for well-built and around 2.5 to thinner patients. This is a needle entry point, okay, of the ipsilateral side to be blocked. See, from the spinous process, 2.5 to 3 centimeters lateral is your needle entry point. What equipments do I use? The LA solution, till ropivacaine was available. LA solution, till ropivacaine was available, I was using 2% adrenaline xylocaine along with 0.5% bupivacaine, but now I am using 2% adrenaline along with 0.75% ropivacaine. I can use spinal needle around 25 or 23 and above. 26, it's too thin, and once you hit the bone, it doesn't walk off the transverse process and it bends. So there is lot of wastage of the needle. Epidural needle is better than the spinal needle, and stimuplex needle, since they are blunt needles, which has a injection port also, so it is better. Coming to the landmark guided video, the patient is in sitting position. You can keep the patient lateral with the side to be blocked on the top, just as in spinal with the head and shoulders relaxed. I am using here a 23 number spinal needle. This is a left sided paravertebral block. What happens is, if you are a right sided person, it's easier to block the right side, and left side the hand and fingers get crossed over, so it's more difficult. okay, I enter the pierce the skin band perpendicular to all planes to hit the transverse process. See, the needle is entered band perpendicular. I hit the transverse process and slowly walk off caudally to enter the paravertebral space by piercing the superior costotransverse ligament. 3 to 4 ml of LA is injected after aspiration. Now you have to understand the needle should not be open to air while entering the paravertebral space. Now this is a LOR method for MRM. All the spinous processes are marked, and then the entry points 3 centimeters lateral are marked. Take into consideration, this is the equipment, 25 gauge spinal needle. Now take into consideration the ergonomics. The back curvature of the patient and my eye level. Suppose if I am standing, the table cannot be lowered further. Okay. Now if I am standing here, the eye level is here, and if I go perpendicular like this, I may not hit the transverse process and go deep further and hit the pleura. So I have to stand so that my eye level is in perpendicular to the skin to hit the transverse process. So in case if you need to stand on a stool or a footstool, or arrange yourself in such a way that the needle is perpendicular. See, now the transverse process is hit. Slowly walk off the transverse process caudally to pierce the superior costotransverse ligament and enter the paravertebral space. This is a multiple injection technique for MRM, modified radical mastectomy. 3 ml is given at each level up to T7. Coming to the PNS guided video. For a cancer breast surgery, you need from T1 to T7. You saw that in the previous video. Now for PNS, I go to the anterior most column. Therefore, I just need 2 level of injections. So here I will give at T1 and T5. All the time I will be keeping in mind the end motor response. See, the transverse process is real. The contractions are seen at the axilla, that is T1, T2, and 10 ml of the local anesthetic agent is given. This is at T5. See, hit the transverse process, walk off caudally to enter the paravertebral space, and here you will see the contraction. At the supraumbilical area, so you can see the contractions very well. Now the main question is where to walk off, whether caudate or cephalate. It's always, you can go off anywhere, but preferably it is caudate, because if you hit the transverse process, the lateralmost part of the transverse process here, okay, and then you walk caudate off, your needle comes in contact with the head of the rib, and hence instead of going inside, you come up more superficial, that is you step up. But if you go cephalad, okay, if you go cephalad, you directly enter the pleura, which is very close here, because the paravertebral space is a wedge shaped space and the apex lies just at the head of the ribs. Okay, this picture is at the rib level, which clearly shows, see, how if you go caudately, you have space, enough space to reach the pleura, whereas if you go cephalad, the pleura is just there. Okay, so caudate is preferred. Now, dermatomes, one need to understand the dermatomes very well to select the level of injection. The axillary clearance needs your T12. So, you have to go at around the C7 level. Breast surgeries needs from T1 to T6. Okay. So, you should plan your surgeries accordingly and plan your injection. The inject at the center of the dermatomes needed, knowing that the spread is maximum for 2 to 3 dermatomes above and below. So, hence indications. So, you can do mastectomy, wherein you can give a single level at T5. For cancer breast surgeries, you may need 2 levels, that is T1 and T5. Fracture, depending upon the number of fractures, either you need a 2 level or single level is enough. For lithotripsy, kidney stones, you can go further down and give it around T9. For herpes zoster, look at the site of lesion and at the center. For this, you can go at around T3. Okay. Pressure monitoring. The pressure in the erector spinae, the paravertebral space and the pleural space have been monitored. What has been noted is that pleural space, the pressures are always negative both during inspiration and expiration, whereas in erector spinae muscle, it is positive in inspiration and negative in expiration, and in paravertebral space it is the opposite, that is the negative in inspiration and positive in expiration. Why this is important is you should never keep the needle open to air while entering the paravertebral space, because in case you have an inadvertent pleural puncture, because of the negative pressures here in both expiration and inspiration, air can get sucked in and lead to pneumothorax. This is a lady who was for lymph node biopsy from axilla. Okay. But then she had huge lymph node swellings all over the neck and in the mediastinum also. There was mediastinum widening with lung infiltrates. We gave her single shot thoracic paravertebral block at T1 level using PNS. So you can see the contractions very well. Complications. Now coming to complications, you have mainly the complications occurring are because of the needle not being perpendicular. You can, if you go direct it medially, as shown in all these pictures, you can have CSF, intrathecal injections. The subarachnoid matter can be damaged, the spinal nerves can be damaged. But if you see the last picture, this is a blunt needle, Tuohy's needle. In spite of the needle being directed medially, there is no piercing of the dura mater or the spinal nerve is not damaged. Okay. Now the other complications are paravertebral muscle spasm. Most of the patients always complain that they have back pain because this block lasts for more than 24 hours. I have to give ice packs for my injection site rather than the surgical site. Okay. Infection, very rare. You have to do under strict aseptic precautions in the operation theater with all the basic resuscitative equipments ready. Hematoma, since it is a blind block, and the space is narrow, you have to do a block is deep, you have to do a coagulation profile before attempting the block. LA toxicity, without the intralipid being available in the vicinity, no nerve blocks should be performed. Nerve injury, if you use blunt needles, it's extremely rare. Epidural and the subarachnoid block only if the needle is directed medially. So remain band perpendicular to the and in the center. Okay. Pneumothorax, it is extremely rare. In all the 250 cases which I have done, I have had one pneumothorax in which the patient was severely emphysematous. okay, but still x-ray chest after 6 hours, or if the patient complains of breathlessness, or at least before discharge you have, next day you have to do the x-ray chest. But the minute the needle is near the pleura, the patient starts coughing. So you can withdraw the needle little bit and then give your injection. Hypotension and myocardial depression, it's rare, but it is seen in very severely compromised patients because of the sympathetic blockade. Now this is just a picture to show the difference between LOR guided, where you enter, and the USG guided. Because in USG guided, the space is wedge shaped, and exactly where you are going in LOR and PNS, there the USG probe is sitting. So you have to direct it from lateral to medial. Okay, and if you do not see the tip of the needle, there are sure complications can occur. That is why there is a fear, because you see the pleura and you go very near from lateral to medial. Clinical pulse. In the thorax, the spinous process of corresponds to the transverse process of the vertebrae 1 below, whereas in the lumbar vertebrae, the spinous process is same as the transverse process. Without hitting the transverse process, never enter or go further. Always it's imperative to hit the transverse process before you proceed further with the needle. Walk off and not drag on the transverse process. You may get false negative. Need not go further entire 1.5 to 2 centimeters beyond the transverse process. Even just when you walk off the transverse process and inject the drug, it acts very well. The needle should always be perpendicular to skin at all levels. The deepest levels are at T1, T2, L4 and L5. The shallowest being T5 and T10. Never keep the needle open to air during the procedure. Best is to use your PNS needle which has a injection port separate. Volume, if excess, can go into epidural space. Even bilateral epidural blocks are seen. Thoracic paravertebral block does not cover your lateral and medial pectoral nerves and nerves to serratus anterior and latissimus dorsi. Hence, for to complete the chest innervation, chest innervation blocks, you need to give a separate pectoral nerve blocks, or you can give a supraclavicular or an interscalene block to cover these nerves. When you are using peripheral nerve stimulator, keep your initial current very low. Stimulation of the sympathetics can cause sudden collapse. I have had 2 patients who had vasovagal attack like this. Intercostal muscle contractions are better felt than seen. The erector spinae block, I'll just compare it with the paravertebral. Erector spinae plane block is a poor man's paravertebral block. It is a facial plane block, simple, safer, almost as effective for somatic analgesia as well as visceral analgesia, but it is not a sole anesthetic agent. Okay, there has been various studies for comparison between the erector spinae and the paravertebral nerve blocks, and they have concluded that paravertebral provides superior analgesia and reduces opioid requirements for breast surgeries. Now these, I have almost finished more than 200 breast surgeries under paravertebral blocks using LOR methods, and around 50 using PNS guided. Mostly the patients were ASA grade 3 and 4. I'll show you my data. Yes, in RAD report, most of the patients were in ASA grade 3 and 4, and almost 100% I have used it, the paravertebral block, as a sole anesthetic agent. Maybe minimum sedation was required, but never I needed to convert to GA. I have not used ultrasound, but most of my blocks are using nerve stimulator and landmark guided blocks. The current used around 0.3 to 0.5 is maximum, up to 1. You can safely give at 1 also. Needles which I have used is mostly pencil point. Initial times I have used spinal needles which were long bevel and sharp. And now I am using the PNS Stimuplex needles having a short bevel, non-cutting 22 gauge. The time required to give my blocks averages around 10 to 12 minutes, and the time for surgical readiness without any additives is around 11 minutes. What all drug I have used, whatever was been available as a private practitioner, whatever I get, that is the xylocaine, bupivacaine and ropivacaine. Okay. And in the recovery, for the first 24 hours, I have never needed analgesia of any sort. And at the behest, I would like to thank all my patients and all my surgeons who have been supportive in this journey of paravertebral blocks. Thank you.